I have a question. Have you ever listened to an album that was so creative and boundary pushing that you had no idea what to make of it? Occasionally, these albums will go on to influence the entire industry, and sometimes they just leave an impact on the individual. In my case, this album is The Big Fish Theory by Vince Staples. I love this album, and seeing as it's turning 5 years old this year, I thought it was really important to go back and look at the project, dissect it, and see the way that it's impacted the culture of rap music and how boundary pushing it truly is. So, without further ado, let's hop right into the underrated gem that is Vince Staples' Big Fish Theory. I was up late night balling, counting up hundreds by the thousand. I was up late night balling, counting up hundreds by the thousand. Real quick, before we start, I'm going to acknowledge where Vince was at in this point in his career. The then 24-year-old rapper had already put out a few projects to critical acclaim. He had put out Hell Can Wait that had bangers like Blue Suede and cemented him as an artist to watch. To this day, my brother and I still bump that song in the car. In 2015, Vince was named an XXL freshman, and he began to truly make an impact on the rap game. His double album Summertime 06 was an even more impressive and focused project than Hell Can Wait. It was met with almost universal critical acclaim and contained some of Vince's best music to this day. I mean, it has North North. North North. And Prima Donna was also pretty good too. Honestly, I'm not as much a fan of Prima Donna as Summertime 06, but that's besides the point. Because on May 18th, Vince announced the name and release date of his upcoming album on The Zane Lowe Show. So, who actually helped this project come to fruition? Well, Vince teamed up with the prodigy producer Zach Sekoff for Big Fish. The then 21-year-old producer had known Vince before the project, but more in a friendly way and not in a professional way. It wasn't until 2016 that they began collaborating. Among the other contributors were some true legends in the industry. First and foremost, Sophie, rest in peace, as well as Flume and, oddly enough, Bon Iver. Also, in 2017, after a chance meeting with his good friend Sophie, Detroit native Jimmy Edgar helped produce 745. There's a tweet that Vince put out after Sophie's passing. He said Sophie walked into the studio unannounced wearing Mickey Mouse ears on the way home from Disneyland with Jimmy Edgar. Like, he has something for you. He played 745, took a water bottle, and left. He says, I'ma miss the homie. As well as Sophie and Jimmy Edgar, he had EDM producers Julio Meja and Matt Roth of GTA, the electronic Nigerian-American duo Christian Rich, and the ex-Black Eyed Peas producer Ray Brady. Most, if not all of these artists, have in some way been involved with the house and electro music in the past, or at the very least, they have a solid amount of time in the industry. Such was definitely the case for Ray Brady and even Jimmy Edgar. So what happens when you take a great rapper and put him on the production of these industry all-stars? On June 23rd, the world found out. The Big Fish Theory came out, and goddamn is it an exciting project. Even to this day, I feel as if the album is a one-of-a-kind sonic experience. When asked about the process of creating the sound of the record, Sekoff was quoted saying, "The sounds emerge out of a way that he picked the beats I sent him. Then I would respond and make new things that I thought were furthering the sound. More synthesizers, heavy bass, and a tempo that was propulsive. Something that was urgent. Because Vince has got a manic and urgent energy. Knowing him for so long, I've always known that part of his personality." And Lord, does this project truly sound urgent. The album takes inspiration from some unique places. Detroit house, jungle, EDM, UK garage, and industrial to name a few. The production is oftentimes danceable and yet chaotic. The tempo fluidly changes from one danceable beat to a slower beat, like on Homage, or the odd hyperpop sounding bridge on Yeah Right. The rhythm and tempo are always at the forefront of these tracks, throwing curveballs left and right that constantly scream for the attention of the listener. Rarely will you find a dull moment on the record. These in-your-face drums and production couple up perfectly with Vince's lyrics. Oftentimes, it accentuates what he's getting at. For example, the slightly dissonant pluck sound at the start of Party People and the body-moving rhythm matches Vince's introspective and suicidal thoughts. He says, "Please don't look at me in the face. Everybody might see my pain. Off the rail, might off myself. Bored with my life as I board this plane. Stewardess ask if I need help." Although the beat is definitely dark in tone, the danceable energy of the track acts as a mask that allows Vince to truly speak his mind unhinged. The title of the album may or may not be based on a theory that fish can grow only to the size of the bowl that they're in. The album seemingly reflects on the ways in which Vince and the black community as a whole have been held back by being put in a smaller bowl. For example, on the opening track, Crabs in a Bucket, Staples reflects on the ways in which people in the music industry and the people around him want to see him at the bottom. If I can't have it, then you can't have it type of mentality. They're trying to keep him and his community in a smaller bowl. And 5 years after this album has come out, that is still true. Just here, I got an article from educationweek.org, and it's talking about the critical race theory ban that's been going through the United States. It says that 26 other states in the coming months are set to consider passing similar laws, which effectively ban the way teachers can discuss with students topics such as white supremacy, systemic racism, and sexism, among other topics. So clearly, the bowls that Vince is talking about are already kind of proving to be true. Now let's take a moment to dive into the two music videos that were released alongside this record. It's actually kind of interesting when you look at it a little deeper. Although Big Fish definitely functions well as a single, and Bag Back is a clear tone setter for the sound of the album, Rain Come Down? As a single? With a music video? Even Bag Back didn't receive a music video, and there are other songs on the album that are certainly more digestible, like 745. However, tis not Vince's style. Vince has never shied away from being a confrontational and outspoken individual with regards to his music and his message. The music videos between Big Fish and Rain Come Down contain some interesting links that are worth discussing, as they give us more insight into the album. Firstly, I'd like to credit the YouTube channel Music Video Decoder for her analysis of the music video to the Big Fish. Her ideas helped me with this video. Go watch her quick analysis for some more insight into the album. You see, we begin the music video to Big Fish with a shot of a fishbowl, with a little goldfish swimming inside. Of course, it's a common saying that goldfish only have a memory of 3 seconds, which with one Google search can be proven false, but whatever. Given this short attention span, goldfish can live in such a small bowl and actually live a normal and content life. Of course, this bowl is not optimal. The ocean or even a pond would be better than a bowl. However, since this bowl is transparent, the fish has no idea that it's stuck within the confines of this invisible prison. Now let's use the symbol of the fish and compare it to Staples himself. In the song, Vince is reflecting on the success he has achieved in the rap game, and the barriers he had to overcome in regards to these invisible walls he finds himself in. He raps, "Swimming upstream while I'm trying to keep my bread, from the sharks make me want to put a hammer to my head." As aforementioned, Vince has found himself and his community trapped inside an invisible prison. Whether that be the prison of mentality like described in Crabs in a Bucket, or literal prisons. To keep with the fish analogy, Staples finds himself swimming upstream, both in the landscape of the world as a black man and as an artist. He tries to push his sound and creativity further, despite many telling him to stop or settle. In the following scenes, we see Vince sitting in a sinking ship as the sharks begin to circle the boat. There's a shot of a life vest, which initially would seem practical to have when you're on a sinking boat, but ultimately, due to the sharks surrounding him, a life vest is futile. He's going down no matter what. Vince is arguing that you can either be a fish comfortably living in the confines of a small bowl, or you can go out to sea and risk being eaten by sharks, or in this case, being taken advantage of or being hurt by people who don't want to see you win. But not only is Vince showing that he would rather embrace the latter path and transcend this invisible prison, he also doesn't care about these sharks that are trying to get to him. He is literally flexing a Stone Island jacket in the middle of this sinking ship. He does not give a singular fuck. The video cuts back to a shot of the fish swimming in a red hue, which fluidly, no pun intended, transitions to a shot of Vince, who is also in a red hue, thus further proving the theory that Vince and the fish are one and the same. The video ends with Vince shooting a flare gun, but ultimately we find him floating alongside the fish. Now, swimming in the ocean, the fish is no longer confined to the bowl, and it makes sense, right? This does happen to be a song all about the life that Vince Staples used to live and how far he's come since then. So how does this video relate to Rain Come Down? Well, firstly, the video begins with a familiar image, a cup, an empty cup. However, this time there's not even water in it, just sand. In this song, Staples is reflecting on his past life, but more so, he's bringing us into this dangerous and unfair life that he's lived. Although there's many possible interpretations of what rain means in this song, I feel that there are two in the lyrics that we can definitively argue. One is the raining of bullets that Vince describes in his first verse, and two, the rain of a sexual nature as described in Vince's final verse. I will continue to examine rain as a motif throughout my analysis of this video. So, we find Vince sitting beside the same boat from the Big Fish video, washed up and with a Sprite bottle at his feet. And like, of course, the rapper has been known to rep the brand in the past, and you know, he has like the North line, so of course it's Sprite bottle. And he spins the bottle and it appears to give him some sort of direction. However, he is spinning the bottle, which means that the direction he's moving in is probably out of control and unpredictable, truthfully. And while this could definitely just be a choice the director made in order to get that Sprite plug, it could definitely mean something more. This video, taking place in a desert of sorts, contrasts glaringly from the Big Fish, both visually and topically. The song is the last song on the album, and it deals with all of the vices and temptations and struggles that plague Staples and his community of Long Beach. The Sprite bottle being something that he's enjoyed since the time he was a child, and has repped for his entire career, being one thing that he drinks at the end of the video, signifies a return to his youth, a return to his past. The last shot of the video, with the fish and the diner in the cup, makes sense then. The rain coming down represents all of the things that fill up one's invisible prison once again. Staples finds himself back where he was before, in an attempt to find safety from the rain, or in an attempt to simply survive. He finds himself in the diner looking just as emotionless and broken as the other two people inside. In a way, this reflects the experience of individuals growing up in lower class America. Born into a life without much inherent opportunity, people often seek shelter literally and figuratively from the dangers of their life, thus trapping themselves in an invisible prison yet again. Of course, Vince makes it known that the audience and the people judging his music often don't truly know or care about him. He makes this clear on Bag Back when he says, "Bag back, better back, back, you don't know me," and repeats that refrain four times. He's also quoted on record saying that no one will ever know what the title of this album truly means unless they've known him for an extended period of time. So honestly, my whole analysis of this could be wrong. I know I'm probably the last person Vince would want talking about his music. However, given this album is 5 years old now, I think it's important to acknowledge that if the Big Fish theory is correct and our analysis is true, then Vince has truly transcended that bowl that he found himself in at the start of this album. This album's sound is one of a kind. Even in 2022, there is nothing that sounds like this album. I didn't even get to mention the booming hyper-industrial banger that is Yeah Right, not to mention a godly Kendrick feature and some even godlier production from Sophie and Flume, or the simple yet dynamic drums and bells on 745 and that wobbly bass, or the ridiculously catchy Juicy J sample on Big Fish. Overall, this album is personal, urgent, in your face, and ultimately, boundary pushing. However, despite how serious the lyrics may be on this album, it still retains an upbeat and danceable energy throughout. As Sekhov said in an interview with Pigeons and Planes, "At the end of the day, we wanted to make people dance, and we realized that's kind of a universal language, rhythm." So no, I might not be the best person to speak on this album and its impact on the industry, but I must say, I will always commend Vince on being daring enough to put out such an uncompromising and experimental record.